It's time for the writer's block. I'm Jenny Carlson here in the newsroom at the Oklahoman, joined by Cedric Golden in the newsroom at the Austin American Statesman. Ced, how are you?
I'm great. What's up, Jen?
Man, lots of sports going on, lots to talk about. But Cedric, even as there have been playoffs starting in the NBA, spring college football, which is big in both of our necks of the woods, the thing that has people talking and still has us talking is Tiger Woods, the win at the Masters, the Sunday comeback. Cedric, Tiger Woods, 15 majors now for him. Just an unbelievable scene. What stands out to you even now, several days after that? What stands out to you about Tiger's win?
What thing that really stands out to me is all these kids have been talking for the last 3 or 4 years. Oh, it's so good to have Tiger back. And I grew up watching him and idolizing him. I wished I could have played against him when he was in his prime. Be careful what you ask for, kids, because the old man is back and he's bringing it. And now all of a sudden, you see guys choking, hitting the ball into the water because of the Tiger factor. They hear those footsteps behind them. So what Tiger Woods brings with him is an army of millions and millions of fans, and 5 or 10,000 of them are following him around at the Augusta National Golf Club. And now that he's back, I think golf goes into a different stratosphere. It's just more interesting when Tiger's in the mix.
Boy, that's the truth. You know, and I was thinking too, Cedric, about the fact that, you know, you look at golf now and you see some of these young guys, as you mentioned. You talk about guys like Dustin Johnson, Brooks Koepka, a long list of guys that played a variety of sports coming up but chose golf in large part because of the Tiger factor. They saw a guy that was athletic, that was exciting, and they ultimately chose golf, and those guys are now in the mix for these majors along with Tiger. It's really crazy how this has come full circle again. But Cedric, the thing that I was thinking about, you know, obviously Tiger's got, he's got some baggage in his background, not just physical, but, you know, off the course too. I hope that Tiger is enjoying himself, because I think in some ways when you know what you know now about his life and all the things that were going on around him, previously, I'm not sure how much enjoyment he got out of some of those previous wins. I hope he's enjoying this. He looked to be after 18 on Sunday, hugging his kids and that big embrace with his son. But Cedric, I hope he's enjoying it, and I hope that it's maybe not as tortured a time as it seems as though some of those earlier years were for Tiger.
You know, I think, you know, I read Armand Katayan's great book about him, and there have been several books written about Tiger. His dad, Earl Woods, programmed him to be a soldier, a robot. Seek and destroy. Don't be liked, be feared, and you can rule golf. And he did for the better part of a decade and a half. But now I think he's stopping to smell the roses. His dad's no longer with us. He's a family man now. And, the ESPNW columnist, Sarah Spain, Jenny, I don't know if you read it, but she wrote a great column about Sunday, how so many people were overjoyed that Tiger won, but that Tiger, that she had a different reaction to the win. She was glad for sports, but she mentioned that Tiger Woods was a bad father and a bad husband for many years, and his wounds were self-inflicted. So he hurt a lot of people when he was falling from grace. She got absolutely torched on Twitter for writing that. And you know what, Jen? I agreed with her. I wasn't overcome with emotion watching Tiger win the Masters. I was happy because it was a great story. It's kind of had a redemptive quality about it. But to me, those were some self-inflicted wounds that he inflicted. And I just thought that sports was celebrating, but there's still some human beings that were hurt by Tiger. It's kind of cool to see him back. This latest incarnation of Tiger plays to the audience. He's smelling the roses. He's happy. He's loving on his kids. He even thanked the media, Jen. When is the last time Tiger Woods ever thanked the media for anything?
Yeah. Well, and you know, too, he nearly got slide tackled by a security person on the course earlier in the week. And, you know, old Tiger probably would have snarled and snapped and, you know, not taken too kindly to that, and he kind of brushed it off. So you hope that he's come through some of that, because I agree, there were a lot of self-inflicted wounds that Tiger did to himself, but then in the process hurt a lot of other people. So definitely a different day for Tiger, at least it seems as though that's the case, and he absolutely makes every golf event he's in much more exciting. So sport is the benefactor for him playing better golf and continuing that comeback trail. You know, as we talk about Tiger in our lead segment, lots of other interesting things going on in the sports world this week, and I mentioned that. But let's go by the numbers in our second segment today, Sed. And here's your number, 35 million. That's the contract, that's the salary now for Russell Wilson. Highest paid in the NFL. That's big bucks, Cedric.
He's not Aaron Rodgers, but he is at the bank all of a sudden. Russell Wilson gave the Seattle Seahawks a deadline to get him signed up or he was going to bail. He wasn't going to sign a franchise tag. He wasn't going to be that cat. He wanted to get his money. He wanted to get shored up for the rest of his career. He got his money. He is the franchise in Seattle. He is their Aaron Rodgers. He is their Tom Brady. And good for him, because I really think that the front office of the Seahawks has made some colossal mistakes, letting some really good offensive linemen go. Russell Okung is one that I remember that was a benchmark guy up front. And so Russell Wilson has been running for his life for the last 3 or 4 years. One of the most sacked quarterbacks in the league. And now at least he's got some financial security while he's on his back running defensive ends in the NFC West. And there are several of them, especially with the Los Angeles Rams. So good that he got his money. What interests me is, how does that affect the market, Jen? Dallas Cowboys, Dak Prescott is up for a renegotiation. He's not going to get Russell Wilson money, but I think that kind of moved the needle in his favor.
Yeah, and that's definitely a great point, you know, and especially, you know, with some of the big contracts we're seeing just around all of sport, you know, it's definitely interesting to see how that's trickled over some of these marquee guys wanting and then getting bigger money. We just haven't seen the mega contracts into the 30 and 40 million in the NFL like some of these other leagues. Obviously, we've talked about guys like, you know, Trout and that sort of thing. The NBA obviously having these max deals now. So lots of big money out there. Doesn't seem to be going away. Seems to be getting bigger, which leads me to my number, Cedric. And it's on the opposite spectrum of the dollar signs. $56,000, that's the reported salary of Breanna Stewart, the WNBA star, plays in Seattle. Speaking of Seattle, we're Seattle themed, but she's the reigning MVP of the WNBA, the reigning championship, the playoffs MVP in the WNBA. But she tore her Achilles while playing in Russia last week. She has to play year-round because the salaries in the WNBA are so low. They're going to renegotiate the contract soon. But Cedric, if the WNBA is serious about growing its league, I know that money is still in short supply with some of these franchises, but a star like Breanna Stewart, four-time national champion at UConn, a known commodity, a known face in women's basketball, the league has got to pay these young stars or they're never going to be able to build that league because they got to go overseas to make the majority of their money. That, to me, says you got to start taking care of these players if you're really going to build on the momentum that they bring to the league.
You know, and it's really sad because, Stewie is a super player. She does a little bit of everything. She can play inside, outside. And when you look at the salaries, I mean, she's a top five player in the WNBA, and she's making $56,000 a year. You know, when a sports writer is looking down on what you make, that's tough, man. That's really tough. We're not running up and down a basketball court all year. And so these women have to go overseas to Israel, to Russia, to China, to places like that to make their money. And then they come back and play in the WNBA basically to stay in shape and to be at home. I know that you follow it really closely, Jen, and a couple of years ago, a team in Russia paid Diana Taurasi like a $1.5 million to not play her WNBA season because they wanted her to rest her legs. She's in her 30s, and she's, to me, she's the best player ever. Obviously, the greatest guard to ever play the game. And so when those teams are investing in their players, and they're not even American players, they're investing in Diana Taurasi, telling her, we respect you enough that we want you to be at full strength for our season. Here's $1.5 million to not play in America. And she takes that money, and she sat out a couple of seasons ago. But then Stewie, hopefully had an insurance policy, blows out her Achilles because she's trying to make a living overseas. So they're going to have to do a better job of marketing. They're going to have to show that they love their players a little bit more. No reason for Breanna Stewart to ever be making $56,000 a year. She's a $500,000 player. They don't pay those kind of dollars. I think back in the day, the Lisa Leslies and the Candace Parkers were making like $250,000. But those women were making so much more money with Nike that it didn't really matter as much what they made for the WNBA.
Yeah, I just think it hurts the product, the WNBA, whether it's an injury situation or a quality of play. If you're playing year-round, if you're playing that amount of basketball and not really having an off-season, much like, you know, the Russian team did with Taurasi, paying her not to play. I mean, they saw the benefit in her rest. So the fact that Stewart is hurt, I think it shed light on this. It might make the WNBA rethink how they're doing those salary structures to try to have their stars fresher, obviously healthier in Stewart's case. We'll see how it plays out. I'm sure it's going to have some impact in some of those negotiations as they go on. Let's turn our attention in segment 3 to must-see TV. And Cedric, this week and this stretch of the sports calendar, a lot of must-see TV revolves around the NBA playoffs. We're in the first round right now, and you're interested in this Clippers-Warriors series for a lot of reasons. We saw the massive comeback by the Clippers in Game 2. Obviously, Boogie Cousins looking like he's going to be gone an extended amount of time. It begs the question, whether the Clippers win this series or not, are we starting to see any cracks in the Warriors foundation?
Definitely seeing some cracks in the foundation, Jen. I don't know if you saw 60 Minutes on Sunday. They spent some time with the Warriors midseason, and those guys, I know they look like they wanted to be anywhere but in front of a camera, particularly Kevin Durant, who just looks like he's really checked out. It's almost like he knows he's a free agent. He knows he's going to be out of there. He had like 6 or 7 shots in that game. That's inexcusable for someone who you've seen very closely light him up. We both have. I think that there's some turmoil in that locker room with Kevin Durant and Draymond Green. With that said, I do believe in my heart of hearts that the Warriors are still the best team in the league. They're going to still win this series in 5 or 6 games. They'll destroy the Clippers the next time they play them, and then they're going to set their sights on some bigger fish. Definitely kind of gives the league, the other teams in the playoffs like Milwaukee and Boston, even the San Antonio Spurs and the Rockets, they have to be buoyed by what happened there. But let's not get it twisted, Jen. They were up 31 points. To blow a 31-point lead, you got to be up 31 points as well. So the next time they're up by big numbers, let's rest assured they're going to put their foots on the Clippers' throats and close them out. So the most talented team usually wins. Boogie Cousins is not going to be back, but they smartly signed Andrew Bogut 3 weeks ago, and he's won a championship with them. He knows their sets. And he's going to provide enough of a presence inside with Kevon Looney that the Warriors will be okay.
Yeah, and I think the margin for error that the Warriors are playing with is so much bigger than most teams in the league. I think it shrunk a little bit when they lost Cousins. But, you know, they just have so much talent, so much ability. They can so quickly recover from a couple turnovers with a couple threes. Their margin for error is just so much bigger than most teams are dealing with. Which brings me to my part of must-see TV. And I don't know, maybe this is the opposite of must-see TV. It's the Thunder shooting woes, Cedric. These guys, through 2 games with the Trailblazers, making just 10 three-pointers, The Blazers have guys that are almost matching that at this point. You know, the Thunder shoots 15% from three in game one. You think it can't get any worse. It doesn't get worse, but it doesn't get much better. 19% from three in the second game. Talking about margin for error, this is a team with a very small margin for error because they don't have the shooters that others around the league do. They're going to have to be better defensively. They've got to win game three at home on Friday night. But Cedric, this was a series that when the playoffs started, people thought that the Thunder might be the team without home court advantage with the best chance to get through the first round. Now, if they don't win the third game, no NBA team's ever come back from a 3-0 deficit to win the series. They look a lot more likely to get swept if they don't win game three, as opposed to actually winning this thing. It's crazy how much has changed in a week's time. A series that people really felt could favor the Thunder now has gone the complete opposite way because of their shooting woes.
Well, you see Paul George over on the bench with that big ice pack on his shoulder in the first quarter, and you're like, man, this guy's beaten up, and he's trying to make shots. He's trying hard. But you know what? I know that they didn't play well down the stretch. I saw Barry Trammell's interview with Russell and the next question stuff, and he's got the PR people over there scared to death, and he's running that thing. But I'm going to tell you, when this series started, I wrote in the Statesman that the most overlooked backcourt in the NBA is Damian Lillard and C.J. McCollum. Those are little guys who are great. They've been great for a while, a couple of all-stars, and they can shoot. And they're making shots, and the Thunder are not making shots. McCollum and Lillard are pure shooters. People talk more about Steph Curry and Klay Thompson, but you look up into the Pacific Northwest and check out those numbers. Those guys are quality guards. They're not great on defense, but they score like nobody's business. I think the Thunder is in big trouble with Paul George is banged up, and I think they need to get Steven Adams more involved. When he's playing downhill and dunking on people, they're much better because it kind of opens the floor up for Russ to drive. And so far, so good for the Portland Trail Blazers. They seem to be deeper. They seem to be fresher. And most importantly, Jen, it's a make or miss business, and they're making shots, and that's why they're winning the series.
Yeah, those superstars for Portland outplaying the superstars for Oklahoma City without a doubt. And it's interesting to hear some of the conversations from Portland. You know, that the Trailblazers have really had postseason struggles the last couple years, and there's a thought that some Blazers pundits, both professional and amateur, say that they needed to split up the backcourt. They needed to figure out a way to, probably keep Lillard, but because McCollum's a very similar type of player, very similar size, you mentioned their defensive shortcomings, which haven't been as obvious in this series, but, you know, there's been some talk that they need to split up that backcourt. But after the first two games of this series, they look like the difference instead of the problem with the Blazers. So it's going to be interesting to see how that evolves as this series evolves. Blazers have held serve. Now let's see what the Thunder can do at home. That happens on Friday night. Lots of fun NBA action coming this weekend. But Cedric, that's it for us this week. That's it for the Writer's Block. So we hope you'll join us next week. Playoffs will still be in full swing. We'll have lots more to talk about. Thanks for joining us.